Hello, this presentation covers periodicity or trends of the periodic table. After viewing this presentation, students should be able to explain different properties that elements will have, including ionization energy, electronegativity, atomic radius, ionic radius, electron affinity, reactivity are examples of periodic trends. Students should also be able to explain and describe why these properties will change either when we are analyzing elements that are within the same column, family, or group on the periodic table, and also apply the trends to explain properties of elements which are in the same row or period of the periodic table. The first property we'll examine is called reactivity. For all of the trends, we will consider the arrow to move from low or small values to high or large values. Reactivity is telling us how easily are atoms going to be able to react to form compounds by either adding or losing electrons. An explanation of this, let's consider the reaction of sodium metal with chlorine gas. The product of that reaction would be NaCl. This is sodium chloride. At the particle level, what's happening is as follows. Sodium has one valence electron indicated by the colored in dot that was to the right of the sodium atom. Chlorine atoms will have 7 valence electrons. These are indicated by the dots which are not filled in. When sodium chloride as a compound is being formed, the sodium atoms will lose one electron, forming a positive 1 ion. Those electrons are going to be transferred or moved over to the chlorine atoms. This causes the chlorine atoms to become negatively charged. We now call them the chloride ions. For connections to consider making with this trend, please refer back to the World of Chemistry video series episode 7 for the demonstration which showed differing levels of reactivity for lithium, sodium, and potassium. Also, a comparison of the reactivity of different halogens which were investigated in the halide ions lab. The trend shown on the periodic table for metallic elements, increasing reactivity, moving down on the table and moving to the left on the table. For non-metallic elements, reactivity increases as you move to the right and as you move up. Also of note here, the noble gases, the rightmost column on the periodic table, are not reactive, so they have very, very low reactivity. Ionization energy refers to the energy which is required to remove one electron from an atom. That energy will be measured in units of kilojoules per mole. An example of this, if we have an atom of sodium and we add energy to it, if we add a great amount of energy, we can actually remove an electron, causing a sodium ion to become to be produced. So we'll have the formation of positive ions because of ionization energy. Ionization energy would be extremely high for the noble gases because of their stable electron configurations. Ionization energy increases as we are moving up and to the right on the periodic table. Metallic elements will more readily give up electrons because that allows them to drop back to a stable noble gas electron configuration, whereas non-metallic elements, being very close to having full outer shells, the better change for them would be to add electrons rather than having electrons removed. What is the common feature of elements that have very high ionization energies? Note that they are noble gases, and they all have completely filled outer shells. The common feature of elements which have the lowest ionization energies, if we consider that these are the alkali metals, lithium, sodium, potassium, these are elements which are have one additional electron in the next highest level. So by losing one electron, lithium would drop back to the electron configuration of helium. Sodium, by losing one electron, drops back to a stable noble gas electron configuration, the same as what neon has. And we see a similar pattern for the remaining alkali metals. Successive ionization energy can also be referred to as second ionization energy, third ionization energy. This is the energy which is required to remove additional electrons from a positively charged particle. So removing a second electron, a third electron, and so on. Please consider the differences for groups 1A, 2A, and 3A for this particular trend. group 1A being hydrogen plus the alkali metals, 2A being the alkaline earth metals, 3A being the boron family. Of note here, really important, please consider lithium. It has a first ionization energy of 520. Its second ionization energy, we see a very, very big jump, a very big increase. This is because lithium will be stabilized by losing one electron. It will be destabilized by losing a second electron. Beryllium, located right here on the periodic table, has two valence electrons. Those electrons will be given up fairly readily to drop back to a noble gas electron configuration, which stabilizes the particle. To lose a third electron, however, would destabilize the particle. So that's why we see the big jump in energy required to remove a third electron. Boron, being in group 3A with three valence electrons, easily gives up three electrons to gain a stable noble gas electron configuration. However, to remove a fourth electron would take an addition of a huge amount of energy in order to take away that fourth electron because, again, this would destabilize the particle. Atomic radius is used to describe the size of atoms. The scale that we're talking about here is at the picometer level. Now, a picometer is 1 times 10 to the minus 12 meters, so this is very, very, very small scale. This atomic radius will be determined by the size of the electron cloud. As you're moving down in a family, if we move down through the alkali metals, we see that the atomic radius is going to increase because you're adding more and more energy levels. Hydrogen has just one energy level, lithium has two, sodium has three, and so on, so we're getting larger atoms. Now, as we move across a period, we see that the atomic radius is actually decreasing. The atoms are getting smaller. And this is because if we consider the third period here, sodium, magnesium, aluminum, there is one additional proton every element slot that we slide over. Those additional protons are going to pull the electron cloud in more tightly, and this will shrink the size of the atom. Please make the connection to the World of Chemistry video. Again, this trend of atomic size was discussed in that video. Ionic radius is used to measure the size of charged particles. We can be talking about cations, which are positively charged ions, which will decrease in size, or we can be talking about anions, negatively charged particles, which will see that their size increases. Connections to make here in the video about the dissolving of salt, there was a comparison of the size of sodium positively charged ions and chloride, which are negatively charged ions. It's also important to compare the ratio of protons and electrons to determine what happens to the size of some of the different particles as they form ions. Now, some other things. Please note the alkali metals are all going to form positive 1 charge ions. The alkaline earth metals will have positive 2 charges. The aluminum family, positive 3. The halogens, minus 1. The oxygen family, minus 2. So there's definitely a pattern for the charges that the particles are going to have. Now, let's talk about positively charged particles. We see that they are going to decrease in size. This is because the particle is actually losing one energy level. Lithium as an atom is going to have two energy levels, 1s2, 2s1. When it loses that one electron, it loses it from the 2s sublevel. So the ions for all positively charged ions are actually going to be smaller than the atoms that they came from. We can also see an increase in the size for positively charged ions as we move to the left. And this is because we are going to have a larger number of protons here for these particles. The larger number of protons will pull more tightly in on the electrons, shrinking the size of the electron clouds for the remaining electrons. When we look at negatively charged ions, we see that their size is actually going to expand. Now here the energy levels stay the same, but what's changing is the ratio now between protons and electrons. For fluorine, fluorine has 9 protons, and as an atom, it has 9 electrons. When it forms a fluoride ion, it's now added one additional electron. Now the ratio is 9 protons to 10 electrons. So the electron cloud is going to expand outward because there's less pull in on each electron. Again, we'll see the trend of the size of the ions decreasing as we move to the right. And the reason for this, again, is that when we have larger number of protons, they can pull in more tightly on the electrons, which will shrink the size of the electron cloud. Please note that all of these ions, fluoride, oxide, nitride, will all have 10 electrons. The sulfide and chloride ions will both have 18 electrons. So the reason why chlorine is going to be smaller, the chloride ion smaller than sulfide ion, is because the 17 protons of chloride can pull in more tightly on its 18 electrons than sulfur's 16 protons can pull in on the 18 electrons that a sulfide ion has. Electron affinity is something which measures the energy change when an electron is added to an atom, again measured in kilojoules per mole. An example of this, fluorine having an electron added to it is going to produce a fluoride negatively charged ion and give off energy. Some of the elements are actually going to be shown as having positive energies, which means that it is very, very difficult to add electrons to them. We see an example of that with the noble gases. Think about it. They're all stable already. They have no need to add any electrons. When we have larger negative values, this means that more energy is being given off. Again, a larger negative value means it's much easier to add an electron. So fluorine is very easily adding electrons, so it has a very large negative values. We see some other interesting things here. Nitrogen is actually an atom where it would be difficult to add an electron because it has a exactly half-filled 2p sublevel. By adding one additional electron, it's actually a less stable arrangement of its electrons. We see similar information here for beryllium and magnesium, both ending in s2 for their electron configurations. So adding an electron would actually destabilize these particles. And our last trend is electronegativity, which uses the Pauling scale from 0 to 4 to measure the ability of an atom to attract electrons from other atoms. So this is used when we have atoms which are bonded together that are going to be sharing electrons. But the key here is that sharing doesn't always have to be equal. The example of water is a very good illustration of this. We know that oxygen has an electronegativity value of 3.5. Hydrogen has a value of 2.1. So we can actually calculate the difference in electronegativity is 1.4. That puts the bond characteristic for oxygen bonded to hydrogen in the region where we would describe this bond as polar in nature. And this means that there is an uneven sharing of the electrons. This symbol indicates that a dipole exists in the bond where the electrons are going to be more attracted by the oxygen, less attracted by the hydrogen. So the hydrogen side of the bond is somewhat positive. The oxygen side is somewhat negative. This causes the polarity of water molecules, which leads to properties like surface tension, polarity, and makes hydrogen bonding possible. The electronegativity trend, electronegativity will increase as we move up towards fluorine, which is the element which has the highest electronegativity value of 4.0. One of the great strengths of the periodic table is the fact that the elements are arranged by repeating patterns of properties, and this does allow us to learn a great deal of chemistry because it frees us from needing to memorize the properties of each element on an individual basis.